CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Thinks himself wise, according to Mr. Voltaire, is a great fool. Well, then, does it also work both ways? Can we say that he who thinks himself a fool is, in truth, possessed of great wisdom? This is a complicated question, since wisdom is often taken for folly, and the other way around.
Who accuses this man?
I do. He stole my son's donkey.
Is this the truth?
I confess.
In that case, I must send you to jail.
But you cannot send Avram to jail, Your Honor.
Why not?
He's the only shoemaker in the town. Who will mend our boots?
That's true. Because we only have one shoemaker, Avram cannot go to prison. Ah, but since we have two carpenters, we will send one of them instead.
Mystery drama, The Village of Fools, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Sam Dan and stars Fred Gwynne.
It is sponsored in part by True Value Hardware Stores and Buick Motor Division. I'll be back shortly with Act One.
This is the story of a town that never existed. Or maybe it did. It's about people who were probably the most foolish human beings in the world. Or maybe they were the wisest. One thing we can certainly say, they have long ago departed this earth. Or then again, maybe they haven't. Well, at least this I can tell you. They lived in a town called Helm. It was a tiny, ramshackle, poverty-stricken village deep somewhere in the remote wilderness of Russia. Or was it Poland? It might have been Lithuania. Oh, well, it doesn't matter. Let the tale begin. Have the storyteller step forward. And what is your name, my good man?
What is my name? You must know my name? The whole world trembles in suspense. The sun will refuse to rise unless you know my name. All right, I'll tell you my name. My name is Mendele Moshe Rothschild.
Rothschild? Rothschild? Oh, my. Are you one of the Rothschilds?
By this question, you mean, am I one of those Rothschilds? Well, it didn't work out the way I expected. What does? Man plants wheat, the Lord sends crows. I'll tell you how my name happens to be Rothschild. One day, I said to my wife, Sorivka, I'm home.
My cup runneth over.
Rejoice, dear wife.
I have rejoiced each day that I've known you. My life has been one uninterrupted festival.
There is great news.
You have mud on your feet.
Such news.
I have just scrubbed the floor.
Listen, Sorivka, listen. A marvel, a thing of wonder.
Take your shoes off.
I, Mendele Moshe, am now a citizen.
Hmm? And what is a citizen?
What do you mean, what is a citizen? Everybody knows what a citizen is.
Oh, I see.
So, my beloved, light of my life, my partner for the here and the now and eternity, how does it feel to be a citizen of the great French Empire?
And what is the French Empire?
The French Empire? This town where we live.
Yes?
Last year it was part of the great Russian Empire. The year before it was part of the great Austrian Empire. And before that, the great Prussian Empire, no?
You're telling the story.
So then, all this coming and going, do you know what it means?
No.
I don't know either, except...
Except?
except that each time they change the czar.
Yes?
Well, 1 year the czar is Nicholas, then he is Ferdinand, and now he is Napoleon.
Napoleon? And what does he want from us, this Napoleon?
He is going to give each and every one of us a name.
A name? Just what I needed. Sora Rivka isn't good enough?
Every citizen is to have a last name.
I already have one. I was born Sora Rivka. I'll die Sora Rivka. It's the first and last name I'll ever have.
You'll have to have another one.
I don't want another one.
It's the law.
Why can't I be called Sora Rivka?
Do you know how many Sora Rivkas there are in just this little town alone? How many Mendela Moishas? I ask you, how could the Tsar ever hope to keep track? But Mendela Moisha and Sora Rivka Rothschild. Well, now.
Rothschild?
I have chosen the last name of Rothschild.
But it belongs to the Baron. The Baron Rothschild.
I can choose whatever name I like. I am a citizen of the great empire.
But Rothschild? Why Rothschild?
Consider. Everyone named Rothschild is rich, no?
Well, yes.
Why? Oh, why? How do you account for it?
Well,
Can it be a coincidence? How do you account for the fact that all people named Rothschild are rich?
I can't.
Then, I'll tell you. It's magic.
Magic?
Rothschild must be a magic name. So, if I take the name of Rothschild, then I too shall become rich. Ha! How simple it is. Soon, you shall have a palace and servants, a carriage and furs. What do you say?
Next time, if you don't take off your muddy shoes, I won't let you come into the house.
Well, anyhow, nothing changed. And all I got out of it was a last name, Rothschild. But for me, somehow the magic didn't work. As usual, nothing ever went right. But I must say, one good thing did happen. I made a friend. Who? You'll never guess. None other than the great Baron Rothschild himself. When he heard my name was Rothschild, he wanted to meet me. He gave me all sorts of jobs to do. He even called me cousin. Well, on this particular day, he sent for me.
Come in, cousin. Sit down. Now, is everything fine and comfortable at home?
You know how it is, Baron. Well, while you live, you're afraid to complain, and after you're dead, it's too late.
Yes. I called you here to ask you a favor.
A favor?
A most important favor. Tell me, cousin, can you undertake a mission for me?
Did you say mission?
A confidential mission.
A confidential mission? Who could tell where it would take me? The great Baron Rothschild. Advisor to all the proud and mighty crowned heads of Europe. Oh, was I to carry a message to the Tsar of Italy? Or France? Or Spain? Maybe Austria? England?
You will do it for me, cousin?
But, Baron, do you think I'm...
qualified? Cousin, from every point of view, you are the best qualified. Now then, I am looking for a certain place. It is called Helm.
Helm?
I want you to find this place, this Helm, for me.
And where is it, Baron?
You'll know when you get there.
I'll know.
That's what he told me.
That's what who told you?
The man who sold me the secret.
There's a secret?
Yes, cousin. A great secret.
A great secret?
Perhaps the most valuable secret in the world. And such a secret. Listen. Just yesterday, a man was admitted to my study. He had a long white beard, ragged clothes, torn shoes. Yes, but with such an honest look on his face. And he said to me, Baron, will you give me 50 gulden? And I said, my friend, if you need 50 gulden, by all means, you shall have them. But he said, Baron, I do not ask for charity. And I said, well, brother, why are you here? And you know what he answered?
No.
He said, I have something to sell you. Well, what is it, I asked. A secret, he replied. What secret could be worth 50 gulden, I asked. And you know what he answered?
I cannot imagine.
He looked at me and he said, "The secret of eternal life." And so I said, "Sell to me the secret of eternal life. Here are your 50 gulden."
"Yes."
And he said, "Very well, Baron. If you desire to live forever, yes, come and settle in our town of Helm. Because ever since the beginning of time, no rich man has ever died there." Do you see, cousin?
"Yes, Baron, I see."
"No rich man has ever died there."
"Now, this is a secret."
"Not today and not tomorrow. Perhaps not even next year. But sometime when I feel... you understand?"
"Oh, absolutely, Baron."
"When that time comes, I shall decide to reside in Helm, as it were."
"Of course."
"Therefore, I must make the proper preparations."
"Naturally."
"A suitable house and so forth."
"It goes without saying."
"In these matters, one requires a confidential agent."
"It will be my pleasure."
"You see now how uniquely qualified you are for the job?"
"Thank you, Baron."
"I rely on your discretion."
"I shall breathe a word to no one."
"Not even to your wife?"
"Oh, rest assured."
Wait. "Do you talk in your sleep?"
"I shall say nothing."
"It will be a long, arduous, dangerous journey."
"I am equal to the task."
"Naturally, your family will be provided for."
"Oh, thank you, Baron."
"Can you leave now?"
"Now" can also mean tomorrow morning. And so, at breakfast, I told my beloved Sura Rifka, "You married a man of importance."
"Who could be as lucky as me?"
"I have a job. The Baron is sending me on a confidential mission."
"I know."
"You know?"
"You are going to look for the town of Helm."
"Who told you?"
"You told me."
"When did I tell you?"
"Last night, when you were asleep."
"Oh, well, you don't want to believe what I say while I'm asleep."
"Why not? I can't believe what you say while you're awake."
"Now, Sora Rifka."
"What did he tell you about Helm, the Baron?"
"He told me to find it."
"Oh, well, you'll find it. You won't have any trouble at all. You know why? Because you're a fool."
"Sora Rifka."
"And Helm? Do you know what Helm is? Helm is the town of fools."
"What are you saying?"
"Everyone knows it. That's why the Baron has chosen you."
"Oh, no.
"Yes, Mendele Moshe. Like is sent to find like."
"I won't go."
"You must go."
"But the Baron thinks I'm a fool."
"Why shouldn't he think so? You are a fool."
You call your husband a fool?
Some men are fated to be rich, others handsome, some wise, and others fools. And yet, all are as one in the sight of the Lord."
"You want me to go, even though you know it's a fool's errand?"
"My beloved Mendele, who else but a fool can be sent on a fool's errand?"
"Who else, indeed? And it is written that there is a time for all things, a time to be wise and a time to be foolish. Well, each of us must follow his destiny. Wise man or fool, we play it out to the end. The trouble is, we can never really be sure which part we are performing. We may find enlightenment in Act Two, and then again, who knows?" Said we would tell you a story about Helm, and so far we haven't even arrived there. So, what's your hurry? We still have two acts to go. Besides, we had a great many affairs to settle before we could start out on such a long, hazardous journey. After all, does one just say, "Goodbye, I'm off to Helm," without so much as a "by your leave"? Anyhow, our hero, Mendele Moshe Rothschild, is finally on his way. Yes, he will discover that every uphill has its downhill, that you can't sell the skin of a bear that's still in the woods, and that a man should live if only to satisfy his curiosity. How are we doing, Mendele Moshe?
How are we doing? We? Suddenly I have a partner. I'll tell you, a fool is the only living thing created by the Lord that grows without rain.
It is now 6 weeks since I left my beloved Sura Rivka to search for the town of Helm. And while I am no closer to it, I feel I am no further from it either. And no one can help me. I have walked hundreds of dusty, difficult miles, and I am sustained by faith. The faith that I will know. Yes, faith. But isn't it written that faith makes a full breakfast, but a scanty supper? Yes, I will confess that there were times when I was ready to admit defeat. And then I came to the outskirts of a tiny village, and I saw a man kneeling in the road. Shalom Aleichem, my friend. And what are you looking for?
I am looking for a ruby.
Ah.
A silver ruby.
Ah, shall I help you look? My name is Mendele Moshe.
Ah, my name is Yitzhak Isaac.
Well, Yitzhak Isaac, as far as I can see, no, there's no trace of your silver ruble. Whereabouts on the road did you lose it?
Oh, I didn't lose it on the road. I lost it back in the synagogue courtyard.
But if you lost the ruble in the courtyard of the synagogue, why are you searching for it here?
How can you ask such a question? The synagogue courtyard is knee-deep in mud. Here, at least, the ground is hard and dry. So, which is the better place to look?
And the moment he said it, a great light began to shine in my brain. Of course. It was so clear, so logical, so right. And I knew. Don't ask me how. I knew. That's all. I knew this was the place I had been looking for. My search was ended. This must be Helm.
What else could it be?
Helm. I found it.
Why do you mean you found it? Did you ever lose it?
I found it.
Helm is like my lost ruble. It slips out of the pocket and it's gone forever?
I have been searching for Helm for weeks, for months.
Is one permitted to ask why?
Isn't it written, to each man his fate?
And what has faith to do with Helm?
You see, Yitzhak Isaac, I am a fool. And so, therefore, I belong here.
Here? In Helm?
Yes, because Helm is the town of fools.
Who says so?
Everyone.
Who is everyone?
Well, it's known.
And you came here because you believe this is the town of fools?
Yes, that's one reason.
My poor Mendele Moshe, you have been deceived. This is not the town of the foolish. This is the town of the wise.
What?
We have no fools here. We have sages. We have no simpletons. We have philosophers. Here, all is learning. The very air crackles with wisdom. Listen.
To what?
The crickets. Listen. You hear them?
Well, yes, but...
To the uninformed, the crickets merely make an idle chirping. Well, perhaps they do in other places, but here, each chirp is a nugget of wisdom.
Oh?
Listen again.
To what?
The birds. To the uninformed, the songs of the birds are merely some random snatches of melody. Perhaps they are in other places, but here, each note is a pearl of profundity.
But I don't hear them saying anything.
Yes, well, neither do I.
Well, then how do you...
Wisdom, my friend, is a ladder. It has many rungs. We, most of us, are still trying to climb up from the bottom. But when one can comprehend the chirping of crickets and the singing of birds, that indeed is the highest rung of the ladder.
I see. You say your name is Yitzhak Isaac?
What else should it be?
You have a long white beard.
There's no credit to me. It was created by age.
Your clothes are ragged. Your shoes are torn.
Is my name Rothschild that I should wear new clothes and whole shoes?
Rothschild? Wait. You have an honest face.
The rest of my body is equally...
You are the man. You are the one who appeared before the Baron Rothschild. You sold him the secret of everlasting life.
And you know why I arranged that transaction with the Baron? So that he would send you to Helm.
Me?
Yes. No rich men have ever died here. But wise men? Like a farmer harvests a rich crop, the Lord takes them in season. Each year we become fewer.
But the Baron sent me because he thinks I'm a fool.
It is written, discretion is the better part of valor. Therefore, it follows that wisdom is well advised to wear the cloak of folly.
Then I am a wise man?
Of course.
But I always thought I was a fool.
That is the true beginning of wisdom. Yes, and one by one you will climb the rungs of the ladder of wisdom. And one day, perhaps, you will reach the highest.
My beloved Sura Rivka, live and be well 100 years. I have found Helm, and Helm has found me. I am here to learn wisdom. I have been asked to be the judge. And what have I learned as a judge? What haven't I learned as a judge? I learned that the wise man must hear one word and understand two. But I didn't just become a judge. No. I was interviewed and examined and questioned and tested. What comes easy in this life?
We have here Mendele Moshe, who is to become our judge.
Why?
Ah, good question, Hanabela. The answer? Because we need one.
I know we need one, but why him?
Why him? Because he's here.
Is he a man of good character? Is he honest?
Put him to the test.
I will. Mendele Moshe, if you found a purse with ₹1,000,000 lying in the road, would you be able to withstand temptation and return them to their rightful owner?
Yes and no. If the money belonged to some big, wealthy millionaire, then I confess I would keep it.
You would?
But if it turned out that the ₹1,000,000 belonged to some poor, hard-working peasant, then I would return every last penny.
This is what any one of us would have said.
This is spoken like a true Helmite. Are there other questions?
I have another question.
Speak.
Tell me, which is more important, the sun or the moon?
Can you answer, Mendele Moshe?
Which is more important, the sun or the moon? It is not to be taken lightly. However, upon consideration, one must conclude that the moon is more important.
You say the moon. Why?
The thing is obvious. The moon is useful. It shines at night, when there is need for light. The sun is wasted. Shines only during the day, when there is no need for it at all.
Solomon. A judgment. Are all here satisfied with Mendele Moshe?
Yes. A Solomon.
I then must ask our judge Mendele Moshe to solve the problem that is pressing this congregation. What shall we do? The poor box has been stolen from the synagogue.
Construct a new one.
But how can we be sure the new one will not meet the same fate?
To safeguard the poor box, suspend it high from the ceiling. A thief shall be unable to reach it.
True. A thief will be unable to reach it, but it will also be out of reach of those who wish to contribute to charity.
Then this is what must be done. Place a ladder beneath the poor box so that all who wish to contribute may do so with ease.
Truly, there is a judge in Israel.
I feel humble because of the great responsibility that has been placed upon my soul. Well, when they look in Helm, they look to me. Yesterday, there were two cases. The first concerned the sexton of the synagogue.
He has neglected his duty. It is necessary for him to wake all the citizens of Helm for midnight prayers.
Yes.
He is paid to make rounds of the village and knock on everyone's shutters.
And he has not been doing it?
No. And so people sleep instead of being awakened to recite the Psalms.
What have you to say to this, Yeshaya Tzvi?
I am very old.
Yes?
And I know I should walk through the town and knock on everyone's shutters, but I cannot walk so far. I am too tired.
I see. Yes. Friends, what is to be done? Can we deprive a man of his livelihood because he is old and tired? On the other hand, if he cannot walk through town to bang on our shutters, how shall we be awakened for prayer? But
There is an answer. Let all the window shutters in Helm be removed and stacked neatly in front of Yishayetsvi's house so that he may strike them all at the same time. Yes, my beloved Sura Rivka, I am kept busy indeed. Daily, I acquire wisdom, the wisdom of Helm. It is true I do not yet understand the chirping of crickets or the singing of birds, but I am getting there. I listen. I listen closely. For on that day, I know Helm will truly come into its own. Helm will become the light of the world. And talking of light, the world will yet be grateful to Helm, because we have saved the moon. Yes, my beloved Sura Rivka, we have saved the moon. It came about this way. Good evening, Hanna Bela.
Good evening, Mendele Moshe.
You seem to be unhappy.
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. May I ask why?
Well, it's... I don't know how to say it. Now, suppose the moon were to stop shining. Well...
Well, what?
Suppose the light of the moon were to go out.
I haven't thought about it.
Why haven't you thought about it?
Because it never happened.
Does that mean you shouldn't think about it?
Well...
And because it never happened, does that mean it never will happen?
All I can say is, don't worry about it.
That's all you have to say?
Yes, what else is there to say?
Oh, don't worry about it.
But who says the light will go out from the moon, Yitzhak Isaac? Who says?
It could happen, yes.
No.
You sure?
Am I sure? Well...
And when the light does go out, then what will we do?
Then, there will be no moon, that's all.
Are we not commanded to bless the new moon every month?
Yes.
If we cannot see the new moon, how will we be able to recite the prayer?
Yes, I see the difficulty.
If the light goes out and the moon is dead, how can we save her?
Let me think. Let me think.
You must admit, only in Helm would this problem occur to anyone. And yet, just because the moon has shed its light all these millions of years, does it mean that it will continue to illuminate the skies? Who is to say that the moon will not disappear tomorrow? How can anybody be sure? I shall return with Act 3 shortly. They say in Helm, send a lazy man for the angel of death. However, at this moment, our little town is not concerned with philosophy. They have a much more immediate problem. What is going to happen if the moon were to lose its light? Suppose the moon were to, well, to die. What then? All right, don't despair. There are wise men in Helm. Believe me, this problem does not defy solution.
We cannot be sure that the moon will die.
Can we be sure it will not?
If you ask me, it should have happened long ago.
What are you saying, Hadabela?
To me, it's the biggest surprise that the moon has lasted till now.
Why?
Look. Look up at the moon.
Yes?
See how it shines. In all weather. All alone up there. With nobody to take care of it. So you know what I say. Bring it down here.
Down here?
Where we can look after it.
Ah, not a bad idea, even if it does come from a woman.
Bring it down here? Bring the moon down here?
Why not?
Well, she's right. We can watch over it.
Protect it. The way it is now, left alone by itself, outside, all night.
Who can tell what will happen?
Somebody could come along and steal it.
Well, now...
It's not possible...
Nobody's stolen it till now.
Until now, we've been lucky.
We must bring the moon down here.
As a judge, surely, Mendele Moshe, you can see the wisdom of such a course of action.
Yes, but...
Ah, there's a but.
How?
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 Yes, how?
Mendela, you are the wisest of the wise here in Helm. How do you suggest?
Friends, I'm afraid nothing occurs to me.
But it must be done.
How?
Again, can one set ladder on top of ladder, climb to the moon and carry her down?
Nah, there is an idea.
Oh, yes, a splendid idea.
But someone would have to climb up the ladders.
Well, of course.
Way, way up on the ladders.
Certainly, and I will do it.
Far, up, out of sight.
Well, somebody has to do it.
And suppose when you are above the whole world and you should become dizzy and lose your balance and fall to the ground.
Oh, no.
Who would then earn a living for your wife and children? No, there must be another way.
Yeah, but how? How can we save the moon?
Wait.
Yes?
The question is how to save the life of the moon. Do you all agree?
Yes. Well,
and what is the life of the moon? Think. The life of the moon is the light of the moon. As long as the moon shines, it is well and healthy. It lives. Yes?
Yes.
And so, if we can capture this light, this moonlight.
But how? If we cannot capture the moon, how can we hope to capture its light?
Friends, the wisdom of Helm can solve all problems.
But how can this be done?
Tomorrow is the night of the full moon. First, we shall say the benediction, and then, we shall save the moon.
What a big, bright, and beautiful moon.
Now then, friends. The barrel.
Well, why do we need a barrel?
A broom. Heim. Push it this way. Good. Right here. Now, the moon is directly overhead. We have here this huge barrel filled with clear, pure spring water.
But why?
For what?
In a moment or two, the moon shall pass directly overhead.
Yes?
See? Look in the barrel. See how the light of the moon fills the barrel? How it shines inside? See?
Yes.
You can see the full moon. It is all in the barrel. Quickly. Avrum, Heim, the lid. Put on the lid. And now, hammer it down. Hammer. My friends. See what we have done.
We have captured the light of the moon.
And now, whatever happens up there, out there, in the vast reaches of the sky, we shall always have the moon. My beloved Sura Rivka, greetings from your devoted husband in the village of Helm, where I grow mightier in wisdom with each passing day. I now must tell you of the great tragedy which befell us here in Helm. One night, we were sound asleep in our beds, when suddenly, the dreaded cry...
Fire! Fire! The bathhouse! The bathhouse is burning! Hurry, there's a fire!
It was a terrible fire, and before anyone could lift a finger to stop it, the bathhouse had completely burned to the ground. A few charred sticks were all that remained of the bathhouse of Helm. Need I tell you, my beloved, of the cloak of sorrow and sadness and gloom that covered the village?
How long can people live without a bathhouse?
What's to be done?
Friends, there is only one thing we can do.
Yes?
We must build a new bathhouse.
A new bathhouse?
We need money.
In all of Helm, are there even 2 rubles we can rub together?
We are not isolated human beings. There are Jews all over the world who would be willing to help us. Is it not written? It is a blessing to give. Yes,
with the help of good, pious people everywhere, what a beautiful bathhouse we shall build. A bathhouse that shall be a glory. And so, I took Yitzhak Isaac along with me for his great knowledge, and Avrum for his broad and strong back. And we began our journey. People, listen to our story. We told them who we were and where we came from, and everyone agreed that Helm simply had to have a bathhouse. Soon, we had enough money. Yes, we had more than enough. We decided to stop at an inn for the night. Do you have a room for three honest men?
Honest men are a novelty in these parts. I'll try to accommodate you.
What do you mean, honest men are a novelty?
Strangers, huh?
Yes, we are going home.
Are you carrying money?
Money.
Well, I hope not, for your sake.
No.
The roads are infested with thieves.
Thieves?
Not just ordinary thieves, mind you. They're having a war in the south, so you've got deserters, all sorts of wandering bandits. They'll cut your throat for a penny.
Then we have no money. Do you think we could have some supper?
I'll bring you something to eat.
Menno.
Shh. We must talk very quietly.
But we have money. We have a good deal of money.
Don't say a word.
Yeah, but we're miles from home.
I know.
And along the way, we are certain to be stopped by bandits.
That's true.
We will never be able to get this money home.
Quiet.
Shh. We must do something. Ooh, I know. We will buy goods.
What? Goods?
Merchandise. We will turn the money into merchandise.
Yes. And this merchandise, whatever it is, how will we get it home to Helm? We cannot hope to carry the money without being robbed. We cannot hope to carry goods either. Yet, wait. Is there something we can buy? Something that doesn't have to be carried, but could arrive safely in Helm. Is there?
Right. You couldn't even imagine it.
Here comes the landlord.
Your supper, gentlemen. Now, you'll be spending the night.
If you have a room.
Oh, yes, we have a room, but please sleep fast. We need the pillows. Hearty appetite.
Did you hear what he said?
Well, he said hearty appetite.
No. He said the word pillows. A wonderful word.
So what's so wonderful about pillows?
What's inside a pillow?
You know what's inside a pillow?
Tell me.
Feathers.
That's the solution.
To what?
Our problem. We will invest in feathers. We can buy sacks and sacks of good downy feathers. The very best. The most expensive.
Yeah, but the thieves would steal downy feathers from us as quickly as they would anything else.
No. The thieves won't be able to.
Why not?
Because we won't be carrying them.
Well, then how can we bring those feathers home?
We won't bring the feathers home.
Then how will they get there?
They'll bring themselves. Yes, my beloved Sura Rivka. The feathers would get home by themselves. Beautiful, valuable feathers of the finest, the softest down. Once they were in Helm, we would sell them and use the money to build a bathhouse. And I knew exactly how we would get them home. And so, early the next morning, we bought hundreds of sacks of the loveliest feathers you ever saw. And we hastened to a high hill. We waited for a strong wind that was blowing in the direction of Helm. We would fly them home. This is the breeze we have been waiting for. Release them. Release the feathers. Oh, look. Fly, little friends. Fly straight to Helm. Yitzhak, Isaac, Avrum, Chaim, see. Look, see how they fly.
Yes.
Straight and true. We shall see you soon. We shall see you in Helm.
It's Mendel. Mendel and Moshe, you're back.
Yes, friends, we're back.
Oh,
Did you raise the money?
Yes, but it was too dangerous to try to carry it home. So, we bought feathers.
Feathers? Where are the feathers?
What? Do you mean they didn't get here yet?
No.
Now, what can you say to that? We released them in a high-strong wind that was blowing directly toward Helm. Whatever could have happened?
Perhaps they lost their way.
Yes, of course, they lost their way.
Well, what can we do now?
Nothing. If they're lost, they're lost.
I know. Get all the feathers from all the bedding in the village, and we shall release them into the wind.
And what good will that do?
Don't you see? These are our very own feathers. They know where we live. So, they will meet the new ones, the strange feathers, high in the air, and they will guide them home.
Oh, a brilliant idea.
An idea worthy of home.
Send up the feathers. And so we climbed the highest hill with all of our bedding and comforters and pillows, and we released all of the feathers into a high wind. And they will meet the ones we bought, and they will conduct them safely home. And so, my beloved Sura Rivka, we are standing here and waiting for them all to return.
And as far as I know, they're still waiting, patiently and hopefully. For every man, woman, and child in Helm still believes that one day those beautiful feathers will descend upon the town. And before you smile at the naivete of these simple, humble, innocent people, you might just pause to ask yourself, what feathers are you waiting for? I'll return with something to tickle your imagination shortly. Say about Helm? What really did take place there? Was it inspired wisdom or absolute foolishness? All that we can say concerning wise men and fools is that the good Lord created them both, loves them both, and needs them both. Remember, God told some people to be wise, and he told some people to be foolish. But he never told anyone to be stupid. Our cast included Fred Gwynne, Bryna Rayburn, and Robert Dryden. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division and True Value Hardware Stores. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time... Pleasant dreams.